fundamental question that is faced by sports is, do they want, will the industry ever allow somebody to tell the truth on the air? But I don't think that today that will ever happen again. I don't think the industry will allow it.
Dino Costa.
It's Tuesday across North America and around the world. And you're listening to the worldwide Dino Costa radio experience on Sirius XM's Mad Dog Radio.
All righty. Dino Costa is on your radio here and now on a, what is today, Mr. Joshua? It is Tuesday what? July the 9th, 2013. That's what I thought, yeah. On Sirius XM Radio. Let me say it again. Sirius XM Radio. It's on Sirius XM Radio, y'all. And how about Sirius XM Radio now? Where the beat, it just goes on and on and on and on and on. How about today's news? What is he talking about? Well, I'm talking about today's news now. Not even remotely unexpected so far as I'm concerned. But I think, well, very unexpected for the rest of the, how should I term it? The rest of the non-satellite radio community, yes, whose heads and hearts sunk a little deeper today with the news. I got it right here. It's in front of me. Guess the news. Here it is. The news that Sirius XM Radio and my forecast and prediction came true. You know, in my first year, rewind the clock now, my first year at Sirius XM Radio, we had just about 18 million people on board. We had 18 million subscribers to the best radio on radio. And that was back in 2009, man. And at that time, I think I might have been 3 or 4 months into my tenure with Sirius XM, and I had always been bullish on Sirius XM before I became a Sirius XM man myself. And at that time, back in 2009, about 3 months into my tenure, I remember it like it was yesterday, I said that before my contract runs out, before my contract ran out, which my current deal here runs out on August 27th of this here summer, I said back in 2009 that before my current deal would expire, that Sirius XM Radio would eclipse 25 million subscribers. And some people told me I was nuts, and I'm sure that radio executives who are still toiling and grubbing along in their counterclockwise, in their stern foremost world of traditional radio, yes, upon receiving the news that Sirius XM surpassed and overtopped 25 million subscribers today, those same traditional radio executives who thought I was nuts to make such a bold statement back in 2009 that at this time we'd be up over 25 million subscribers. Oh, those traditional radio executives. Many, many of whom are listening to the sounds of this show right now. Oh, you live in a world of predictable and utterly stale and repetitive programming. You live in a world filled with, how should I say this, Mr. Joshua? Those radio executives in the world of traditional radio, they live in a world of what? Non-plus personalities, constant breaks that see extremely limited programming content on an hour-by-hour basis. I've got a very good feeling that these dinosaurs in the dinosaur world of traditional radio, that once again today with the news that Sirius XM has gone up and above the 25 million subscriber mark, these fossils in traditional radio, not only do they continue to see their future in a dying medium, But more than ever, I think that traditional radio executives and those involved in their very laborious efforts to raise the sinking ship that is traditional radio, more than ever, these individuals feel like network television living in the world of satellite and cable-dominated TV. The route continues. The route continues. The future is here. And I'm just smitten with this news today because it actually was a forecast, as I said before, that I had made back in 2009. And you, the SiriusXM listener, by the way, you're completely aware of the fact that you, too, you saw the future when you became a part of the SiriusXM radio family. And so I guess with this terrific news making the rounds in the offices in New York City and throughout the country where we have SiriusXM personnel all over the place, I guess without any further ado, and on behalf of this groundbreaking and singularly uncommon and ultra-innovative company known as SiriusXM Radio, SiriusXM Radio, and the Dino Costa Show, we collectively together thank you for making SiriusXM Radio the largest, the most listened to, and the biggest and baddest and best radio company that planet Earth has ever seen. 25 million of you with us now. Next stop, 30 million. Oh, it's very exciting. Very, very exciting. This is the Dino Costa Show, and it is with Rich Mendes and Aaron Gerberg at the controls in New York. Mr. Joshua is with me here in Wyoming, USA, until 8 o'clock out west, 11 o'clock on the East Coast. With your numbers, the digits to participate on this here Tuesday show as follows: 888 and Mad Dog 6, and that would be 888-623-3646. And, oh, by the way, you know, yesterday and last night I spoke up about the Anna Benson and Chris Benson saga, which for a serious situation is as funny as anything I've ever looked at. And today, some more specific and detailed information coming out from the police department down in that Georgia town where Anna Catwoman Benson endeavored to hold up her husband at the point of a pistol yesterday morning. So I'll get to that. There's so much to get into on this Tuesday show, which is the second of five award-winning and blockbuster endeavors. How I'm even here this afternoon as I think about it is a complete and total mystery. It's a miracle in and of itself. Seeing last night, after I got done watching the Rockies game in San Diego, not to mention a few other games I was channel surfing after I got home after the show last night, I made the mistake of flipping over to the Giants and the Mets game and stayed with that sucker as it went 16 total innings, ended about 2 o'clock Mountain Time out here in Wyoming. Then I made the mistake of getting into last week's Sports Illustrated. So I watched the Giants and the Mets game till about 2 a.m., excuse me. And then I got Sports Illustrated. I made the mistake, as I said, of getting into it, which until last night, last week, Sports Illustrated, I had only given it a very cursory glance over. This is the Sports Illustrated with Dennis Rodman on the cover. And if you remember, last week I harpooned Sports Illustrated for putting that creature, Dennis Rodman, on the front of the magazine. I made mention last week during the show that I thought that Yasiel Puig, or especially the Pittsburgh Pirates, merited much more consideration for the cover of Sports Illustrated. But hold on now. Hold on now, because I said I had only, just a second ago, I said I had only gleaned pretty much the front cover of the magazine last week up until last night at about 2 a.m. Then when I opened it up after that 16-inning game in San Francisco last night, I happened to notice it was a special double issue of Sports Illustrated, and it was a, where is it? Mr. Joshua, can you please reach into my bag and get me that Sports Illustrated? It was a Where Are They Now issue of SI last week. And I got to tell you what, something happened there with the microphone. I got to tell you, I went through virtually the entire edition of the magazine last night, ended up getting to bed at about 5 a.m. because I read through the entire magazine. It was, let me compliment SI, because that was one of the best issues of Sports Illustrated that I've had the good pleasure of making my way through. They had a feature story on the aforementioned Yasiel Puig, and it goes without saying. I mean, it really does how much I absolutely and positively love this guy. I've spoken about him many times over the last few weeks, and the story that, hold on one second, where is it? Here it is. Ben Reeder, the story that Ben Reeder did on Puig was not only a great read, and I don't know how much you know about Puig, Other than he's impossible not to watch, you got to watch the guy. I mean, you cannot turn the guy off. I mean, he's the most fascinating player in Major League Baseball right now, you know, which is why I think it was the last time before the 4th of July holiday, before we had a few days off here, which is why I said that Major League Baseball, and I made my case, and I understand the arguments coming back the other way, but in terms of advancing the game and creating more exposure and visibility for this massively talented player, I just think it's in the better interest of Major League Baseball to have Puig in the All-Star game. And but, you know, the story in Sports Illustrated goes into specific detail. Read the story because you'll like it a lot. As I was on my way to saying, it goes into real specific detail about how the Dodgers became aware of Yasiel Puig in the first place. And really, when you read the piece, you come to comprehend. It's amazing. The Dodgers signed a player in Yasiel Puig. Not only signed them, but signed them to a massive contract that some in the baseball community thought was ludicrous. This is indicated in the story. And the reason for the healthy dose of skepticism from others in the baseball community concerning the Dodgers signing of Yasiel Puig is that the Dodgers signed Yasiel Puig to a 7-year contract worth $42 million. And they did this without ever having him seen play. They never saw him play a game. In a game. They had never seen him play in a game up close and personal. Now think about that. I'm not sure, and as I was making my way through the story, I did not know this until I read the story last night, late in the morning, and I was aware of the fact, obviously, that Puig was a defector from Cuba, so on and so forth, and I'd imagine his trip to the States was harrowing, just like a lot of these players that defect Cuba and come to the States. Their trips are oftentimes filled with, well, it's a life-or-death experience in a lot of cases. I knew all that, but I didn't know. I mean, I'm not sure in the 40-plus years I've been watching baseball if I've ever heard of something like this. To me, it's almost the equivalent of going to look at a car, not being able to test drive the car, not knowing anything about the car's history. You get to turn the car on, turn the ignition, turn the car on. You get to listen to the sound of the engine, and then you agree to purchase the vehicle for, say, I don't know, anywhere in the neighborhood of $50,000, $60,000, and you haven't even had an opportunity to drive the damn thing. The only thing that the Dodgers saw on Yasiel Puig before signing him was they watched him take batting practice 3 times in Mexico City, which has got an elevation of over 8,000 feet. So they saw him play, in batting practice, that and some film on him playing for the secondary Cuban national team. That's it. Nothing else. They basically saw him work out, hit some balls in Mexico City, and then they lavished a 7-year, $42 million deal on him. I mean, think about that. This has got to be unprecedented. I'm sure that in baseball history, players have been signed in similar capacities, similar situations where a scout has run a player through a workout, for instance, and then signed them to the organization. But the player was probably, you would think, sent to the team's lowest minor league classification, and his bonus was probably the bus ticket to get him there. Puig, on the other hand, takes 3 rounds of batting practice for the Dodgers, then gets a $42 million deal the next day. Stunning. Stunning. Go read the story if you haven't yet. It would be well worth your time. I promise you that. Last year on the show, I was reading the story late last night. I was thinking about it a little bit today. And last year on the show, I couldn't stop talking about Mike Trout. I was loving me some Bryce Harper. Manny Machado talked extensively about Brett Laurie with the Blue Jays last year, Votto in Cincinnati. I mean, you know, the game really right now, it abounds with just brilliant young talent right now, and it's really intoxicating to me. Because as I continue to say, there's nothing like young talent in Major League Baseball. Matt Harvey, for instance, with the Mets this year. Carlos Gonzalez, Troy Tulowitzki with my Rockies. Jose Fernandez, the young pitcher in Miami with the Marlins. McCutcheon with the Pirates. Cespedes out in Oakland with the Athletics. I could throw more names into the pot, but you get my drift. The game is just flush with young and continuously emerging talent that is must-see stuff. But this Yasiel Puig, I got to tell you, as excited about Harper and Trout as I was a season ago, and I remain high on those two players. How could you not be? Puig has me even more transfixed than Harper and Trout, collectively maybe. I mean, listen, I hate the fact he's in the National League West and in Los Angeles when I would prefer that Puig was playing right field at 20th and Blake in downtown Denver. But my goodness, what an exhibit this guy is. Now, obviously, I think, you know, he's not going to be able to continue the pace that he's been on. I checked the box score earlier today, last night in Arizona, in a Dodgers win over the Diamondbacks. Puig went 2 for 5 with a run scored. I checked before the show. He's still above the 400 mark. He's batting 409 going into action tonight against Arizona. And when you think about the impact, the dramatic impact, I mean, you want to talk about an impact. You want to talk about a dramatic impact. He has not only been responsible for making the Dodgers relevant again in the National League West, but his rub-off effect on the rest of what was truly a dead team walking in the Dodgers prior to his arrival, it really has been as stunning as anything I've seen on the Major League level in 40-plus years of watching Major League Baseball. Not only that, but if Don Mattingly should get a contract extension either during the season or after the season, in my way of thinking, he should give 15% of his salary to Puig, because Puig would have absolutely and positively, without a doubt, saved Mattingly's job as well. You do also realize, do you not? I don't know how close you've been paying attention to Puig. Again, I'm not sure that, and it's why I want the guy in the All-Star game. I mean, I continue to go back to this. It's why I want Yasiel Puig in the All-Star game, because I want as many people to know about Puig as possible. Not as many people watch the All-Star game now, with good reason, as they have years ago, but still the same. Major League Baseball needs this guy on a stage. They need this guy on a stage. And I was on my way to saying that you do realize that Puig was hit in the face with a pitch a few weeks ago. You know this, right? You're aware. You ever been hit in the face with a 90-plus mile-an-hour fastball? Think that some players, hell, many players would be a little maybe gun-shy after taking a fastball to the face. Puig was hit in the face with a fastball. Puig, though, not only was he hit in the face with a pitch, but I'm telling you, the guy is like a damn transformer, seemingly made of steel, this guy. Have you seen the makeup of this guy, the build on this guy? He gets hit in the face by the fastball. He gets up. He runs his hand over his face as though a fly landed there, and he's swatting the fly away, walks to first base, and then he continues his rampage on National League pitching staffs as though he was nicked on the forearm by the pitch, you know? Let me give you another example. This just comes to mind right now. Last week, when the Dodgers played the Rockies in Denver, my Rockies, I saw a play, and I was annoyed at the time, where Puig was on third base for the Dodgers. Ground ball was hit to first base. Okay, ground ball hit to first base. If memory serves me correctly, Jordan Pacheco was playing first base in this game for the Rockies. Picks up the ball, throws the ball home to try to get Puig. The throw was right on. It was a perfect throw to the plate by Pacheco. And Puig should have been out by 7-8 feet. Yet, Willene Rosario was the Rockies catcher at the time, awaiting the throw home. And Rosario knew that Puig, a.k.a. Optimus Prime, was steaming down the third baseline like a bullet train leaving the station, okay? Puig was coming down the line. I mean, he was dead. He was dead. 7-8 feet, he was going to be out. Ground ball to first, Pacheco picks it up. Puig's going on contact. Pacheco throws the ball home to Rosario. He's out by 7 or 8 feet. But here's what happened. Rosario, clearly aware that Puig might just toast him, might blow him up at home plate, was so distracted with the locomotive ambling down the third baseline that Rosario flat out dropped the ball on a perfect throw home. He wanted no part of Yasiel Puig. The guy is built like a battleship. So, but the story in SI is great. This is a great story. You've got to check it out. It's a great story on Puig. This is also the second of five award-winning and blockbuster shows this week, the Dino Costa Show on SiriusXM's Mad Dog Radio, and so many things to get into on the show over the next 4 hours, and some what I feel is very disturbing news coming out of Calgary, Alberta, Canada, that I ran across today as I was looking at a few things. It's got nothing to do with the floods that hit Calgary a few weeks ago. Instead, it's got, you know, in 10 days, just about 2 miles from where I'm sitting right now, the world's largest outdoor rodeo is going to commence with the 117th edition of Cheyenne Frontier Days. It's the daddy. It's the daddy, baby. The daddy of them all. And it's an event that has been held out here in the Mountain West, here in Cheyenne, since 1897. And as a participant and a spectator of the daddy of them all myself for a few years, I can tell you it is a great nearly two-week spectacle of not only rodeo, but parades, a pancake breakfast here in downtown Cheyenne that has got to be seen to be believed. There's a two-week carnival. You've got Frontier Concert Nights featuring some of the biggest musical acts in the country. And essentially what it is, it's nearly a two-week-long festival and a celebration of Western culture and history. Now, even if you don't consider yourself a cowboy or a Western enthusiast, I can tell you that this event needs to be on your bucket list because it is more than special. Anyhow, until today, being the Western and rodeo fan that I've been for years, on my own personal bucket list, one of the things I've always wanted to do is to head up to Alberta, Canada, up to Calgary. To take part in another great traditional rodeo, also one of the larger rodeos in the world, and that event is taking place right now as I speak, and it's called the Calgary Stampede. Maybe you've heard of it. But based upon some information I received today about Calgary's Stampede Rodeo, some people up in Calgary, I'm afraid they have absolutely and positively lost their minds. And based upon what I myself consider to be an insulting as well as a filthy and disgusting decision, this year rodeo fan will probably never, ever see Calgary in my lifetime. And if I do, and I'm going to get to this, I don't want to get to it yet, I'll get to it. We've got a lot of things to get to over the next 4 hours. But if I ever go to Calgary, it's going to be to see a Calgary Flames game and not the previously great Calgary Stampede Rodeo. So that's not going to be happening. More on this later, like I said. A lot of ground to cover, a long way to go on this Tuesday. And something else, by the way, hit me last night. As I was doing some reading, some perusing on board the internet after the marathon game ended in San Francisco between the Mets and the Giants and the Mets. And, you know, so hey, listen to this. This is one of the things that was really sort of eye-opening to me. This is July 9. We are sitting here on July 9, 2013. And to me, I don't know about you, but it feels like we just ended the month of May. A day or two ago. To me, it feels that way. And to add to that, how quickly the calendar and the days are flying by, and we are just zooming by. While I'm talking about, I was just talking about Yasiel Puig and the Dodgers situation just a few moments ago. We're smack dab in the middle of a Major League Baseball season, right? We got news and information on Major League Baseball of the negative kind that I'm going to get to with the Bud Selig and Major League Baseball possibly suspending a host of players shortly after the All-Star break. So we're going through all this stuff. How about the fact, you want to talk about how fast the calendar's moving? How about the fact that the opening week of NFL preseason games, I'm looking at a magazine last night, I realized that the opening week of NFL preseason games, 30 days from today. 30 days from today. You don't believe me? Go check when your team plays their first preseason game. 30 days from today. The Broncos and the 49ers, 30 days from today. So what's that mean? Well, you get the NBA, you get the NHL seasons that just ended, and I guess a new campaign in both those two sports starts in a few weeks. It feels like it does anyway, you know? And if you don't mind, allow me, since it's here in front of me, allow me to get back to last week's double issue, the Sports Illustrated that I referred to earlier, the issue of... What does it say on the front here? It says, Where Are They Now?, which was a terrific essay. The Dennis Rodman story I found to be repetitive. I mean, how many changes with Dennis Rodman really can you expect? I mean, he's the same guy today he was 10, 15, 20, 25 years ago. But you know what other story in last week's essay was as compelling a read as anything I've mused over lately? They did this Where Are They Now? Piece on a bunch of people, and they did a Where Are They Now? Piece on the guy I consider to be the greatest quarterback who's ever played the game, Joe Montana. And, of course, it's very subjective. Some people agreeing with me, some people howling in protest. It's fine. You think someone else, that's okay. For me, it's Joe Montana. And when I made my way through this Montana story in Sports Illustrated last night after watching a night filled with baseball, the story It almost brought a tear to my eyes, but not for the reasons you might think. Not for the reason. I wasn't getting melancholy and Pollyannish over Joe Montana and the story in Sports Illustrated for some of the reasons that you may be thinking. Far from it. Instead, the story on Montana, when I was making my way through it and reading it, it transported my mind back to a time and back to a place where the NFL was really and truly the great days of the National Football League. And by the way, Joe Montana, I might, just as an aside here, getting to the point that I want to make, Joe Montana, unless the story is an inaccurate representation of the greatest quarterback who ever played the game, in my estimation, is a story. It's not only the greatest quarterback, Joe Montana, who ever played the game, and of course he's a Hall of Famer, but as the story illustrates, if you make your way through it, and who did this piece on Montana, by the way? Hold on, let me check it real quick here. It was one more page back. Who did this piece on Montana? It was Michael Rosenberg is the guy that did the piece on Joe Montana. And Montana, who's pretty much out of the public eye, and has more or less been so since his career ended. Joe Montana, as great of a quarterback as he was, the greatest in my opinion, as I've said now for the third time, is even, as the story indicates, he's even a better father and a dad to his children, and he's an even better loyal and loving husband to his wife. And the reason I mention this, of course, is because, as I was alluding to on the show yesterday, the vast number of professional athletes who are involved in, you know, things like numerous extramarital affairs, the acute amount of womanizing that is pervasive in the lives of professional athletes, the high incidence of divorce rates and divorced athletes, not to mention the negative connotations that are often attributed to professional athletes for, you know, one various reason or another, the Aaron Hernandez situation. This leaps to my mind as I think about this now. And as I mentioned this yesterday on the show, sometimes in both serious and sarcastic, tongue-in-cheek, humorous ways yesterday, and I'm making my way through the Montana read yesterday, Montana breaks the mold. And I'm kind of getting off track here because there's a bigger point I want to make, but Montana breaks the mold of this stereotype that we talk about when it comes to professional athletes so very often. His greatest accomplishment, so far as I'm concerned, is more than just what he's done on the football field. His greatest accomplishment, so far as I'm concerned, is in holding his family unit together for so long. Not a hint of scandal has ever been around Joe Montana. And now you consider this, you say, well, okay, fine, maybe it's not as big a deal to some of you as it is to me, but consider that this is Joe Montana I'm speaking about here. This is not some quarterback who enjoyed a brief modicum of success in the National Football League. Joe Montana was the biggest name in the National Football League among quarterbacks for years and years on end. But the misty-eyed part, No, I haven't forgotten, and here I go to explain this. I'm reading this story about Montana last night in Sports Illustrated. You know, what he's doing now, and that's personal speaking engagements, the four Super Bowl wins, the three Super Bowl MVPs, the ground-shaking end to the 1982 NFC Championship game, the throw to Dwight Clark that forever changed the fortunes and the dynamics of the 49ers franchise, all the great stuff about Joe Cool, Super Joe Montana. And by the way, I also want to throw this in reading the story about Montana, it's very clear to the reader that the least impressed person in the world with whatever accomplishments he produced on an NFL the playing field, the least impressed person in the world is Joe Montana himself. Utterly, utterly unimpressed with himself. But let me get back to this, because as I read the piece, my mind, again, this is where the melancholy, this is where the Pollyannish thoughts, this is where the misty-eyed feeling started. My mind was transported back to a time. It was impossible not to for someone. I'm 50 years old. I've seen a lot of NFL football. Okay? But my mind was transported back to a time where I remember how much I loved the National Football League. How you make your way through the story, and if you lived through the years of the NFL that I did, how you become instantly aware, your mind is transported back to that time where the NFL not so long ago was the league that was devoid of the consistent problems that plague it now on an almost everyday basis. It's the league I loved. It's the league I hunger for. It's the league I remember, but the NFL back then. And when I say back then, it wasn't all that long ago. The NFL back then that I speak about with such such reverence is the National Football League that is almost like a person who passed away and is never coming back ever again. I mean, and I'm making my way through the Montana story in Sports Illustrated, and I'm clearly remembering a league when we talked about the NFL. It was always in a fashion and in a style and in a capacity that promoted the game. It was spoken, the NFL was spoken by folks who reveled in the game's incredibly exciting atmosphere. Reading the Joe Montana piece last night in last week's Sports Illustrated brought back to my mind a time when the NFL was king. When football was celebrated and not torn down by the forces who seek to heap the invective upon it that they do with regularity these days. Reading that Montana piece last night, trying to put this in the proper context for what, it made me remember. It made me remember when NFL football was played like NFL football is supposed to be played. It made me realize that I, and many of you, of course, were fortunate enough to have lived through what really truly can be considered to be the NFL's golden age. We were fortunate to watch the game when it was at its zenith. The Montana story brought that back in full clarity for me, at least at its zenith in terms of how the game was played, how it was meant to be played, how it was played. I'm making my way through that piece yesterday, and I'm thinking about Montana, and I saw all his career and all his Super Bowls, and I'm thinking about the 49ers dynasty. I'm thinking about the Chargers helping Kellen Winslow off the field after that incredible Chargers and Dolphins playoff game back in the early 1980s. I think it was 1983. I'm thinking about, you know, Montana, of course, was the focal point of the story, and I consider him to be the greatest quarterback who's ever graced an NFL playing field, and the 16 touchdowns that he threw with nary a single interception. Think about that. In the four Super Bowls, he played 16 touchdown passes, four Super Bowls, not one single interception for Joe Montana. I'm thinking about great moments in the NFL, and I'm thinking, my goodness, this NFL doesn't exist anymore. I'm thinking, I couldn't help but to think about great moments. I mentioned a few of them already. I was thinking about the Music City Miracle with Frank Wycheck and Kevin Dyson to stun the Bills and turning the city of Nashville into an insane asylum on that Saturday afternoon. I was reading this piece last night on Montana, and I was going back in time and thinking about an NFL that I loved. That NFL I'd kill for. I'm reading the piece last night, and I got forlorn reading the piece. Why? Well, because it's clear to me, as I've laid out example after example, to you over the last nearly, 5 years I've been here, that the National Football League will never, ever be the same again. Never. It's still riveting on occasion. That is when the nanny staters get the hell out of the way and let the game be played the way it was intended to be played. But for the most part, you know, as I've indicated time and again on this show over the years, the NFL's best days, think about this. This is as depressing as it gets, is it not? The NFL's best days are behind it. Behind it! Read that story. Make your way through the Sports Illustrated that I did yesterday. Maybe some of you are still in the midst of doing so. And, you know, if you're someone who can remember the NFL's golden age, if you watched it, if you lived it, if you immersed yourself in it like I did. Tell me. You tell me if that story in last week's SI on Joe Montana, if it doesn't make you hearken back to an NFL that was utterly and totally and completely and positively intoxicating and as galvanizing as anything you can remember, when great plays and even greater players were the narrative in the NFL. When we talked about the NFL, it was all positive. And what is the thing I lament almost daily here? Every single piece, every shred of information, especially since this man has been running the ship. The NFL is dealing with one fire. They're putting out one fire after another. At every turn, there is another fire starting in the NFL, and none of the fires are being started in a positive way. All of them are negative. There's very rarely an instance where the National Football League, as I talked to you about this many, many times, there is rarely an instance in the NFL in which the National Football League is talked about in positive ways. I'm making my way through this piece on Montana in Sports Illustrated, a Where Is He Now piece, and refreshing are the memories that are pouring into my mind at a time in the National Football League when names like Goodell weren't found, where something as asinine as a defenseless player on the field was unthinkable. When tackling, you remember tackling, and hard hits. Who's for hard hits on a, raise your hands, America. Who's for hard hits on a football field? When tackling and hard hits, they were not only celebrated, they were encouraged. And when officials usually did their jobs and did them pretty well. I'm reading this piece on Montana. I'm thinking back to a time in the NFL not all that long ago when lawsuits were, what, extremely sporadic. And when the thought of 4,000-some players, and there's news on this that I'm going to get to today, when the thought of 4,000-some players suing a league and potentially destroying its very foundation in the process was something that was considered to be an absolute and total unthinkable act that nobody could have foreseen. Nobody. Indeed, I not only enjoyed the story on Joe Montana, but I enjoyed the story as much about Joe Montana as much as I did for bringing me back to a time and back to a place that unfortunately the NFL will never be at again in its history. And that is, that's pretty sobering. But anyway, go and read that that piece. I think you'll like it. I got sports media news to comment on today. ESPN's ratings are down significantly. I want to get to that. The thing I mentioned just a second ago, the judge in the case concerning the NFL players' lawsuit, the 4,000-some-odd scumbag former players, most of them are on the balls of their financial ass. They have not managed their money well. This is why they are sucking at the teat of the NFL, hoping for a Jesse Jackson-like corporate shakedown. The judge today, Anita Brody, ruled something that was sort of unexpected. I'll get to that. Also, as I made my way through various sports sections and different things online today, I ran into a story on the Wall Street Journal's website, and this is the month that back in 1983, it actually happened on July the 24th, 1983. I'm talking about the George Brett Yankee Stadium Pine Tar game. There was a terrific story in today's Wall Street Journal. The bat boy who was assigned to the Royals dugout and clubhouse that day has told some more finite details of that day that were never revealed previously. A terrific story in today's Wall Street Journal. I want to get to that, go over some of that. I mentioned before the Major League Commissioner, the de facto himself, Bud Selig, is planning, according to an ESPN report earlier today, to suspend as many as 20 or 25 players after the All-Star break. We will get to that. I thought the Lions, with an excellent move today, extending Matt Stafford. I will get to that. Roll your phone calls in as well, 888 and Mad Dog 6, 888 and 623, 36 and 46. I'm just underway on a terrific Tuesday, the second of five award-winning and a blockbuster Endeavor's Living Western on a Tuesday. This is the Dino Costa Show on SiriusXM's Mad Dog Radio, and I'm back with more great stuff, I promise, right after this.
A slave to his job 24 hours a day, every single day of his life, providing you with one blockbuster show after another. This is Dino Radio, the Dino Costa Show, and it returns right after this.
Cowboy. Cowboy.
Dino Costa.
Well, I'm packing up my game and I'ma head out west, where real women come equipped with scripts and fake breasts. Find a nest in the hills, chill like Flint, buy an old drop top, find a spot to pimp. Then I'm a kid, rock it up and down your block, go with a bottle of scotch and watch lots of crotch. Buy a yacht with a flag saying chillin' the most, then rock that bitch up and down the coast. Give a toast to the sun, drink with the stars, get thrown in the mix and tossed out of bars. Zip the Tijuana, I wanna roam, find Motown, tell the fools to come back home. Start an escort service for all the right reasons, and set up shop at the top of Four Seasons. Kid Rockin', I'm the real McCoy, and I'm headed out west, sucker, because I wanna be a cowboy, baby,
with a top left back and the sunshine shining.
Cowboy, baby,
west coast chillin' with the boom smiling.
I wanna be a cowboy, baby,
riding at night cause I sleep all day.
Cowboy, baby,
I can smell the beat from a mile.
He's America's nighttime sports radio voice of reason. This is the Dino Costa Show, and you're experiencing it right here on SiriusXM's Mad Dog Radio.
No two shows ever the same. It is the Dino Costa Show on a terrific Tuesday. Show number two this week, second of five award-winning and blockbuster Endeavors on SiriusXM's Mad Dog Radio, 888 Mad Dog 6. Throw the damn suit out, will you please? Anita Brody, throw the damn suit out! Throw it out! Every time I think of this, obviously you know how disgusted I get. These 4,000 maggots. You're dead to me. I don't give a shit if you were the greatest player in the NFL and you're part of this 4,000 person class action lawsuit. You're dead to me. You're absolutely and positively dead to me. You're nothing but a handout maggot is what you are. And the reason I bring this up is because last August, the National Football League, in lieu of this ridiculous, asinine, nonsensical, tragic lawsuit that these maggots were bringing against the National Football League, they asked Anita Brody, and I told you to keep your eyes on that name because she was going to be the central figure in this whole thing. The NFL asked Anita Brody to dismiss the lawsuit, and she heard the arguments in April. Brody did. Today, she ruled. Now, she said back then, she said, I'm going to rule on this thing when I sort this thing out for myself. So since they gave the opening arguments in April, Brody has thought about this, and today, according to the New York Times, as I saw this on the New York Times first, she's postponed her decision on whether or not to scuttle the lawsuit brought by these 4,000 maggots. She's postponed it until September the 3rd to give the two sides more time to negotiate. Negotiate what? Negotiate a settlement? To me, and listen, I'm just talking instinctively here, gut reaction, this favors the National Football League more so than it does the 4,000 maggots who are clamoring to get at some of the NFL's dollars that they certainly and positively do not deserve. The New York Times says the two-month window for the mediator, she wants us to go to mediation. The two-month window gives Brody more time to write or adjust her opinion on whether to dismiss the case or not. Dismiss the case! Throw the damn thing out! And, of course, the players are going to appeal if this happens. Let me tell you something. I would say above 90% of all of those maggots' names, 4,000 and counting, that are on that class action lawsuit, the players in that lawsuit, the former players, they're broke. They're riding the financial balls of their ass right now. They were negligent with their money. And now they're writing out this lawsuit in an effort to make ends meet. Maggots. I don't know how you can have any respect for people like this. None. I don't have any respect for these people. 888-MAD-DOG-6, Grand Rapids, Michigan. Let me go get some phone calls here at the end of hour number one. David's there, and he's on the Dino Costa Show, hour one on this Tuesday. Hi, Dave.
Hey, Dino. Totally agree. You know, Junior Seau didn't kill himself because of concussion. He killed himself because one day he wasn't the king anymore. And this is what I got to ask you. Of those 4,000 punks that are on that lawsuit, every single one of them played college football, correct?
Yeah.
That's why it's a meritless lawsuit. Why aren't they suing the NCAA? Because there's not the dollar bills in the NCAA that the NFL has.
I think you refer to it in the correct fashion. It is a meritless lawsuit. It is meritless. It is a sign of these disgusting times that we live in. And if this judge has any common sense in her head, this Anita Brody, if she's got any sense, she will rule before the end of my show here today and tonight that the lawsuit is without merit and she'll throw it out on its ass and this thing hopefully will find a way to be over.
Now, these socialists are going to win out, man. It's football is done. I love it, but it's gone. It's not like it used to be for me.
Well, it's like I said before. I mean, the late great days of the National Football League, making my way through that Sports Illustrated story last night made me acutely aware again. I mean, it's not something that I just was able to stumble upon last night. You've been aware of this. I've been talking about this for years here. That the great days of the National Football League, the best days of the National Football League have already happened. And I make the parallel that I'm reading this story on Montana last night, and I'm saying, my goodness, I remember this NFL, this great NFL. What are we talking about today? Lawsuits, concussions, players offing themselves, Goodell transfiguring the game in grotesque ways. New language entered into the NFL lexicon, the defenseless player. The what? Man, Andy's in Atlanta, Georgia. He's on the Dino Costa Show, hour one on a Tuesday. Hi, Andy.
Hi, Dino.
Hi.
I was wondering, I always wondered this myself. I'll take your comment off air. How do you think Joe Montana would have panned out if he'd went to the Falcons? Do you think he'd have been in the same quarterback he was with San Francisco?
Oh, you know, it's an impossible question to answer. It's an impossible question to answer. He played with the 49ers. And to me, big games, big moments, money on the line, chips on the table. I've never seen a quarterback better than Montana. And could you imagine Montana in today's NFL? Montana would throw for 7,500 yards in today's NFL. Charlie's in Hollywood, Florida. He's on the Dino Costa Show, hour one on a Tuesday. Hi, Charlie.
Hey, Dino, how you doing?
Hi, Charlie.
Man, I have to say, you blew my mind. I was driving home from work, and I had no idea that Puig had that contract that large. 7 years, what did you say, 7 years, $42 million?
7 years, $42 million, and they basically gave him the contract after they watched him take batting practice.
Right, and that just blew my mind. I can't even fathom that. But what I was thinking after you said that was that, with all the new talent, with the Mike Trouts and the Mikados, and there's just such a new there's new blood coming into the sport that was dying after the steroid era. You know, everyone was saying baseball is dead,
right?
And like you really saw it dying. I grew up a baseball fan, and I just kind of for a couple of years there, it was just like it's kind of unwatchable. And then all these guys with immense talent, and they're not they're obviously not using steroids. They kind of
Hold on now. See, this is the unfortunate aspect of the whole thing, Charlie. You're right. The influx. You're echoing my comments and my sentiments. The influx of young talent in the game is a sight to behold. However, all of these guys, whether we're talking about Puig, whether we're talking about Machado, whether we're talking about Trout, Harper, McCutcheon, Matt Harvey, Votto, bring about any name you want. Unfortunately, because we have just come out of the era of the steroid times in baseball, and who knows if we're out of that era, we don't, all these guys, Chris Davis of the Orioles, all these guys, they're under a cloud of suspicion. It's unfortunate, but it's the mindset, it's the mentality. I'm going to get into more of this as we roll forward on this Tuesday. A long way to go and a lot to do. 1 hour done, more of your phone calls. This is the Dino Costa Show. It's here on Sirius XM's Mad Dog Radio on a Tuesday. One done, three to go.